So this is the Commodore Amiga CD32, and it's quite a landmark machine. First 32-bit CD-ROM based console. This is one of the first edition ones. It was manufactured in September 93. Can you see that? And most of the reason why it did so well in the UK and parts of Europe. It had its limitations. It didn't have any storage capacity for save games, unlike its technically equivalent counterpart, the Amiga 1200. But the fact it was a console, the fact it had CD, was a massive buying point for a lot of people. And the hardware wasn't too shabby itself. It ran on the 1200 AGA chipset, which, although it wasn't good at 3D, was pretty much more powerful than most other things available at the time. Point of contention is always the control pads. Control pads look like they're upside down. In fact, they're not upside down. They're designed like that. I quite like them. They're quite cheaply made, but then Commodore were on a bit of a cost-cutting exercise and trying to make a quick buck, which they did for a very limited period, until 3D machines came out, machines with better architecture, better capabilities, and a fucking save game feature. The all-important 32. That was like the badge of its time. It's like when you have a car with GTI written on the back. Yeah, look at my car. This is 32. This is like, yeah, check my games console out. You've only got 16 bits. I've got 32. I don't really know what that means. But 32, hey? Look at the grey colour. It's lovely. Look at these photo sockets. You can play CDs out of your stereo speakers for a games console. How crazy was that? Two controller ports. Rocker switch at the back. It's got an expansion port here as well, so you can plug stuff in. You could plug various peripherals in, which were sort of, you could essentially make this into an Amiga 1200 by ramming stuff into it. Bit of a Frankenstein Amiga 1200, but you could do it if you wanted to go down that route. If you wanted to go down the console route and then the conversion route, if you were that way inclined, if you were a bit of a mentalist, huh? First, let's look at these clips. The clips that inspired me to like it in the first place. Although I didn't actually own one myself at the time. Too much money!
I never found out why he chose me to share his secret. Perhaps because we had similar dreams. But this was twice as fast. Twice as powerful as anything I'd ever thought possible. Though what that meant, I could never have foreseen. Incredible graphics and colors, so many colors. Our world would never be the same again.
Have a look at this. The new Amiga CD32, the first 32-bit console to be launched in this country. Software? Well, there's not very much of it around at the moment. There are only 4 games available, but more are promised by Christmas. 80, in fact. Honest. Now, when you buy the console, you get all the usual bits and pieces. You get your mains adapter, etc., and you get this rather strange-shaped controller. Why it's this shape, I've no idea. It doesn't seem to improve playability. In fact, it's just a nuisance. You also get 2 games. You get a game called Oscar and this one, Diggers, which is, well, it takes ages to get going, and then it's really slow, and it's sort of like Lemmings, but it's nowhere near as much fun. But amazing 32-bit games are coming, they promise us. This is called Rise of the Robots, a futuristic beat-em-up that makes full use of the machine's huge palette of over 16 million colours. And, like any CD system, it makes full use of CD-quality sound and CD-quality music. And as we've said so many times on this programme before, you get a better value of game for your money on CD than you do from a floppy or a cartridge. And that's because, of course, a CD can hold so much more information. This, I'm sure you'll recognise as James Pond Robocod. But on the CD32, this game has an amazing 140 levels. I only hope they've included level codes.
To begin the story of the CD32, we have to get down and dirty in the 1980s, and more specifically the latter part of the 80s. At that time, Commodore were dominating the home computer hardware scene, especially in the UK and Europe, where the PC had yet to establish a firm foothold for the average home user. This was in part due to the higher cost of the IBM compatible machines, but also because the tried and tested method of a rectangular shaped computer hooked up to the home television had been in place for a decade. Starting off with the affordable Sinclair ZX80 back in 1980 and surging forward like a digital juggernaut. The Commodore Amiga range, along with the Atari ST models, seemed like a natural progression from the 8 to 16-bit technology, and the superior capabilities of the Amiga helped it to quickly dominate this scene. However, before the 80s were out, a new type of computing device started to take over the television screens in homes across the land. This computing device was called the Games Console. What crazed witchcraft was this, you ask? These sleek, shiny, keyboardless devices, in the common guises of the Master System and the NES, seemed to appear in homes overnight, and their even lower cost of entry soon caused a rumble across playgrounds in every corner of Europe, and, indeed, the United States. Commodore, of course, recognised this, and only a few years later, with the onset of a Mega Drive, the market quickly started to overlap directly onto their home soil. Here was a machine capable of very similar graphics and sound to their beloved Amiga, but it was more accessible, it was cheaper, and in a lot of senses, it was cooler. Plus, it had blast processing! Commodore had initially tried to hit back with the doomed CDTV, offering the latest in fangled compact disc technology, but unfortunately just not cutting the mustard, instead trying to fill a gap that didn't really exist. Indeed, the only gap it created was the £699 hole you'd have in your bank account if you decided to buy one. Even worse, they took another stab at pushing the already outdated Commodore 64 hardware out as a console in the guise of the Commodore 64 game system. And although it was clearly aimed at the lower end of the market, it was too far behind the curve to be a success. So, Commodore were feeling threatened, which soon put their cogs into motion on a higher and more determined level. The appearance of the SNES in the early 90s further rubbed salt into this wound, and clearly something had to be done. Something different and something better. Commodore's first port of call was to launch the successful Amiga 600, which was aimed to directly compete with the 16-bit consoles of the time, but it didn't cut as much swathe as had been hoped. The Amiga 1200 was then launched, which was an upper-range computer appealing to a specific niche, typically a niche that could afford to buy the increased processing power, and probably wanted to show it off to their friends, who at the time had graphically underpowered and game-lacking PCs. The cartridge-based formats of the consoles was also offering more than disc-based systems probably could offer. Let's be honest, spreading a game over several discs or requiring a disc swap just to get to the title screen, I'm looking at you gods, isn't the most convenient. Combine this with the fact that piracy was rife on floppies, and you can see why publishers were equally as keen to switch. Clearly, someone at Commodore was keen to push on with the CD format, which offered the best of both worlds. In fact, it was difficult to pirate, but cheap to produce. The advent of a Mega CD format helped to cement Commodore's chosen direction, and soon, out of the dwindling finances of the Commodore pot, in the summer of 1992, a rather hasty CD32 idea was born. And although it was designed to make sales as quickly as possible, it was also a good enough piece of kit to stand a chance. The ace that Commodore had up their sleeve was the fact that they already had some pretty good technology in the shape of the new Amiga 1200 AGA chipset. Simply by robbing this and whopping in a CD drive, Commodore cleverly realised that they could arrive in the home console market in some style, which they specifically targeted this time after learning the mistakes of their all-in-one CDTV attempt earlier, which, to be honest, was way ahead of its time, with consoles such as the Xbox One now only starting to fit that arena. So, they arrived in style, and they did it with the first 32-bit based CD console available in Western Europe. In fact, it was only beaten globally by the Japanese exclusive FM Towns machine, which possessed internal 32-bit architecture, but in fact only possessed a 16-bit data bus. So, time was on Commodore's side, but it was also rapidly beginning to run out. When the CD32 hit the market, the only real competition the machine faced was Sega's Mega CD, a machine with which the CD32 actually drew a lot of comparisons, with similar intro screens, a similar technical specification, with the Mega CD being two 16-bit 68000 processors as opposed to the 168020 in the 32, and they both employed similar marketing tactics. Both machines were aimed at the same area of the market, although Amiga were keen to point out that the additional 16 bits afforded to the CD32 meant more than it was worth, as well as the fact that it didn't need an engine donor 16-bit console to keep it running, just like a patient being fitted with a pacemaker. The CD medium had now been out for a few years, and this meant that publishers had been given a chance to get to grips with the technology, and were able to produce software titles in quite a short space of time, which was handy, as Commodore had made the naive decision to keep the console under wraps for as long as possible, so that rivals didn't try and pip them to the post. David Pleasant, Commodore's general manager, acknowledged this mistake during an interview in a special preview edition of Amiga Format, which was cleverly named Amiga CD Format. And although Commodore launched in time for Christmas 1993, their software promises didn't meet the available lineup, which was somewhat of a disappointment for consumers, and was almost certainly a factor in why the CD32 didn't storm the market as well as it could have. In the interview, David also talks of the misunderstanding which arose when Commodore told half the publishers there would be a new CD product, and the other half that there would be an add-on device for the Amiga 1200. The intention was for publishers to produce software for the 1200 with the scope to enhance it for the CD32 format. What happened was the opposite, with many publishers creating CD-based software for a new unknown console, and then attempting to scale it back to fit the 1200 later. This meant that CD titles weren't suited for the CD32 control schemes, and that many titles weren't available for the 1200 as early as they could have been. Price-wise, the CD32 was aimed to undercut the Mega CD by quite a margin. At the time, Sega's CD add-on was retailing for £369, with a Mega Drive another £100 on top. The CD32 was poised to enter the market at just £289, with some retailers selling it even lower than that. And that was pretty darn competitive, although still fairly expensive for the general masses. It was well out of my budget at the time, I can tell you. Even when I tried to compound several Christmas presents and birthday presents together, it was still too expensive. But at the time, Commodore also lowered the Amiga 1200 price to $299 as well, so that the CD32 wouldn't compete for the same market share. So when it came to the US market, there was never really an intention to launch there, as Commodore's retail presence was deemed simply too small to make an impact. In fact, David's words were, "It's something that we completely laid down, kicked our legs in the air, and let ourselves get raped on several years ago." So, a blunt, if not accurate, way of putting their impact on the important American market. Internally, the CD32 was almost identical to the 1200, which, given the rush to get the hardware created, was expected. Although it didn't feature a B52 quote printed on the motherboard, something that had been synonymous with older machines, but hey. Ultimately, this similarity with the existing technology was a good move, as it opened up the CD32 to a swathe of software designed for the older Amiga models. Commodore also decided on adding libraries into the CD32 workbench ROM that enabled it to be compatible with most of the CDTV titles. Not massive, but another small win which may have won over the few consumers who had jumped onto that early, I won't say bandwagon, wheeled bucket maybe? So, although the CD32 was essentially identical to a keyboardless and floppyless 1200, it did actually possess an additional chip named Akiko. The Akiko chip was a gate array and combined multiple features of other Amiga chips into one smaller package. However, it did have an extended feature in that it was able to perform chunky to planar conversions, which would ordinarily consume many cycles of the 6820 processor. It was requested by Amiga's software group, as most software was currently being developed in chunky pixel mode, suitable for PCs. This function converted these chunky pixels to Amiga bitplanes, so essentially it allowed 3D games to run faster, as if they were on an expanded 1200. It still ultimately wasn't enough to compete with machines such as the 3DO or the up-and-coming PlayStation, but it did give the CD32 the edge for the plethora of first-person clones that were soon due to arrive on the scene. The unfortunate fact, however, is that most games were designed to run on the 1200 as smoothly as on the CD32, so for most software titles this extra chip didn't really serve much purpose other than to conduct a bit of electrical current and just toss it around the board. Now, obviously the CD32 had a CD-ROM drive instead of a floppy, with the drive itself being a double-speed 300 kilobit per second transfer jobby. The drives themselves were actually made by Sony, yes, the same Sony of PlayStation fame, but the electronics and the microcode were jointly developed by Commodore and a Japanese camera manufacturer called Chinon. The drive operates on a custom interface, so isn't compatible with IDE or SCSI, and for audio it acts as a full 16-bit 8x oversampling player. Of course, the CD32 also possessed line outputs so that it could be hooked straight into your hi-fi, which was quite a novelty at the time, and definitely a selling point for those torn between buying a new CD player or a games console. However, one major issue of possessing a read-only memory drive is the distinct lack of save capability, and indeed Commodore shot themselves in the foot a little with this one. The CD32 did actually have some internal flash memory for save functionality, but it was 1 kilobyte. Such a pitiful amount that hardly any software could make use of it. Most save games consumed far more than 1 kilobyte, so at most you could save your progress in one very simple game, which had to be overwritten each time. It was ridiculous. The machine did, however, house 2 megabytes of RAM, the same as the 1200, which, given that the Mega CD only contained 128 kilobytes, was a vast amount. The onboard processor was the Motorola EC68020, clocked at 14.32 MHz in NTSC regions, or 14.18 MHz in PAL regions, which was its main region. It possessed both internal and external 32-bit data buses, making for a true 32-bit machine, whatever that really meant. Performance-wise, it was a reasonable step up from the 68000 found in the Amiga 500, 600, and also machines such as the Mega Drive. You could probably compare the 68000 to a high-end 286 machine, maybe a very low-end 386, and the 68020 to a very high-end 386, possibly a very low-end 486. The machine was capable of displaying a 24-bit colour palette of 16.8 million colours, with up to 262,144 on-screen in Ham 8 mode, with absolutely no colour clash. Yeah. Resolutions were at a tidy 320 by 526 pixels in line with television standards, and audio was provided by 4x8-bit PCM channels with a 28kHz DMA sampling rate. In ROM resided Amiga's Kickstart 3.1, the same as you'll find in the Amiga 1200, just with CD-ROM support and the additional CD-TV libraries I discussed earlier. Taking an external look at the machine, you may or you may not notice, depending on the openness and focus of your eyes, that the machine has a handy S-video socket for much improved picture quality when compared with the standard RF connection, which was commonplace in the day. The system also featured a serial port for connection of a keyboard, audio-video jacks for stereo output, controller ports which would happily accept a mouse so that games such as Cannon Fodder were still playable, and indeed actually incorporated some plug-and-play style technology whereby the system would sense the controller type and do pointer conversion so that a joystick could be used as a mouse and vice versa. The most appealing connector of all, however, was a full-edge expansion socket located under a flap at the rear of the unit. A notorious point of contention were the control pads, with their radical upside-down look causing absolute fury with some people, and others accepting and even liking the new design. I, for one, am in the latter group. And even though the D-pad is a little wobbly on the cheap side and prone to breaking after prolonged use, I just don't care. It's another feature that sets the machine apart. The pad features numerous buttons, with the main button labelled 1, 2, 3, presumably because it acted as all three fire buttons for most previous Amiga titles, which were limited to single button joystick controls. If you weren't happy with the controller, you could always buy yourself a grey, Mega Drive inspired Competition Pro pad, which is nice enough, feeling rugged and purposeful in the hand. As you may notice, buttons on the pad are clearly labelled for CD player control, with standard skip, play, stop and pause functions clearly visible in an embossed style. Power to the Grey Beast was supplied through your standard Amiga style block, which had a 4-pin DIN plug, with the supply itself being lower powered than your typical Amiga box, so unable to sustain a large number of peripherals. In fact, if you look carefully on the bottom of the supply, you'll notice the label stating C65. That's right, these power packs were in fact the original supplies destined for the ill-fated Commodore 65 line, which was due to replace the Commodore 64, but never made it past a working prototype stage, much to my sadness and intrigue. God, I wish I could get my hands on one though. Anyone got a spare one? Please? The CD32 launched in September 1993 to considerable fanfare, with promises galore about the software that could be expected before, yes, before Christmas. The console had limited appeal in the States, as predicted by Commodore, but received a very warm reception in Europe, notably in the usual areas of the UK and Germany, which was helped massively by being the first CD 32-bit console in these areas. This was absolutely huge at the time. I remember the excitement surrounding it clearly. 32 bits was the console equivalent of a Porsche with all the optional extras, not including a floppy drive or a save game feature, mind. Still, the celebrity chosen to endorse the console in the UK was Chris Evans. Yeah, woohoo! Better played was Commodore erecting a huge billboard outside Sega's UK headquarters with the slogan, "To be this good, takes Sega ages." Not a bad attempt, I must say. Well played, Commodore. Well played. David Pleasance continued to remind consumers of the pros offered by the standalone CD32 over the cumbersome, outdated, and modular Mega Drive's Mega CD combination. But unfortunately, component supply problems left Commodore short on meeting their targets, and even though the console sold over 100,000 units in Europe alone, little did he know, well, he probably did to be honest, but round the corner lay a few problems in the shape of the PlayStation and Sega Saturn, which were only a year from release. And that's not including the 32X either, which further Frankenized, is that a word? Yeah, Frankenized the already abused Mega Drive. As with every other platform ever released, software is crucial to its success, and in this respect, it could be viewed that the CD32 had great fortune, with its technical ability to run most of the huge Amiga back catalogue. However, in reality, gamers wanted more. They wanted to see the full potential of the CD format, they wanted to experience the new controls, and they wanted a machine that was ultimately better than their friends were. The 32-bit badge had to mean something, so developers had a lot of work on their hands to meet the expectations. Sadly, most didn't rise to the challenge. Launched in September 1993, Commodore promised up to 80 games ready for the festive season. This included 18 titles which were already ready, but most of the titles promised were quick 1200 ports. Promised titles included, from Bullfrog, Magic Carpet, with its incredible graphics for the time, it must be said. The already popular Syndicate and the trend-setting theme park were also due. Gremlin Graphics had a CD32 version of Zool at the ready, but like most of these, it was a straight port of a 1200 version with a pre-rendered CD-ROM intro slapped at the start to try and woo audiences. Many houses were promising cartoon quality graphics, which sounded incredible, with games such as Oscar and Surf Ninjas attempting to bridge this gap. Microprose were keen to attempt an AGA conversion of Civilization for the CD32, but the problem with the lack of save game functionality played a huge problem. This wasn't the only title that gamers lost out on because of this shortfall. With the disk drive expansion far off, it was frustrating times. Many games relied on a password system to save your progress, but seriously, can you imagine Civilization with a password save system? Please. As Bad Influence had earlier reported, James Pond 3 was getting ready for the machine. And although it featured extra levels over the other formats, these really weren't the extras that most CD console owners were hoping for. Sure, extra levels was good, as was extra sound and better music, but the hope, and this is certainly true in my book, was for something much more impressive and much more incredible on the graphics level. The appetizers being served weren't really cutting the mustard in this way. And the new titles were certainly better than the CD TV titles, but they needed more oomph. Things would get better with the onslaught of first-person perspective games due around the corner, such as Alien Breed 3D and Gloom, but these were unfortunately not quite enough and they came far too late to help the machine and ultimately Commodore's fortunes. One golden nugget that the CD32 had, of course, was the increased storage capacity, which allowed for the corny 3D rendered intros at the start of games, but it also allowed things like the Lotus Turbo Trilogy to be viable. All three Lotus games on one piece of storage medium? Come on, now we are talking.
So, I'm going to play some Amiga CD32 games. And there's a couple of ways I could do this. I could emulate the 32, and I could capture it directly from the PC, and you could see a nice full screen image. Or I could do it this way, and this is the way I would prefer to see it. It might not be the way you prefer to see it, but I like to get the whole setup, to get the whole situation, the ambiance, and take it all in. I like to see the console, I like to see the old style CRT TV. Just makes it feel more real. Let's get started. So, first up, I'm going for a bit of Zool action. Ah, stupid. Oh, got some slowdown, got some jerkiness. Next up, Pinball Fantasies. Let's go for Speed Devils, shall we? Okay, we've got flipper controls. Left D-pad and blue button. Now this is one of the all-time great pinball games. Pinball Fantasies, Pinball Illusions. Very good physics. Last Ninja 3. Let's go. Oh my god. Oh my god. Having some serious trouble here. There we go. You're supposed to be a ninja, come on. Simon the Sorcerer. Hey Simon. What are you up to? Bit of sorcery? Oh, yes you are.
For my first trick, pulling the dog out of the hat. Thank you, Chippy.
Now for some credits.
Now, although this intro isn't magnificently graphically technical, the voice is synced from the CD, I would imagine. And if you listen, the voice is actually Chris Barry, who plays Rimmer in Red Dwarf. Okay, so this is where the...
Dear Simon, I am pleased to announce that you have been chosen from literally hundreds of hopeful candidates to perform a death-defying but extremely worthwhile quest.
Cursor to pointer conversion comes in handy.
All you have to do is rescue me from the hands of the evil sorcerer...
The Chaos Engine! CD32 version. Nice, nice touch. I wonder if there's any other enhancements, or that is it.
Sometime in the last century, an experimenter in time and space created a bizarre machine, the Chaos Engine.
There's always something about isometric or top-down shooters that you just don't get with other games. Okay, and I also wanted to load up a cover disc, just because, for me, cover discs hold a lot of nostalgic memories. Now this doesn't look very impressive now. To be fair, back then, it didn't look very impressive either. But it was a Doom clone running on something that wasn't a PC. And that was impressive. Degeneration! Last but not least, Banshee. Hey, Amiga DOS. Hello. Not enough memory available. Oh my word. There we go. Memory has become available.
Sadly, Commodore International filed for bankruptcy in April 1994, causing the CD32 to be cut short only months after its launch. The name was initially bought by a German company called Escom, who relaunched the Amiga under the brand Amiga Technologies GmbH. They continued to sell the Amiga 1200 with their Magic Pack, which initially sold well. This was followed by the sale of the existing Amiga 4000 stock. However, the CD32 was no more, with Escom realising that its technology had probably lived its short but purposeful and bright life. Thankfully, the CD32 had sold well enough initially for publishers to continue making and selling software for the reasonably niche market, for months even after its demise. But as with all these things, when the writing is on the cards, there's little you can do to change it. I never owned a CD32 myself, until recently that is, but I did own an Amiga 600, which I adored, and my huge appreciation of that machine, combined with my excitement for the CD and 32-bit technology at the time, made me want one badly. It's just a shame I had to wait 20 odd years, but hey, like they say, good things come to those who wait.
And today's hot tip is never put a floppy disk in an Amiga CD32 because it's got a bloody magnet on it, hasn't it? Staggering. I've got to go to the pub. See you later.
NES seemed to appear in homes overnight. and their even lower cost of entry soon caused a rumble across playgrounds in every corner of Europe, and, indeed, the United States. Commodore, of course, recognised this, and only a few years later, with the onset of a Mega Drive, the market quickly started to overlap directly onto their home soil. Here was a machine capable of very similar graphics and sound to their beloved Amiga, but it was more accessible, it was cheaper, and in a lot of senses, it was cooler. Plus, it had blast processing! Commodore had initially tried to hit back with the doomed CDTV, offering the latest in fangled compact disc technology, but unfortunately just not cutting the mustard, instead trying to fill a gap that didn't really exist. Indeed, the only gap it created was the £699 hole you'd have in your bank account if you decided to buy one. Even worse, they took another stab at pushing the already outdated Commodore 64 hardware out as a console in the guise of the Commodore 64 game system. And although it was clearly aimed at the lower end of the market, it was too far behind the curve to be a success. So, Commodore were feeling threatened, which soon put their cogs into motion on a higher and more determined level. The appearance of the SNES in the early 90s further rubbed salt into this wound, and clearly something had to be done. Something different and something better. Commodore's first port of call was to launch the successful Amiga 600, which was aimed to directly compete with the 16-bit consoles of the time, but it didn't cut as much swathe as had been hoped. The Amiga 1200 was then launched, which was an upper-range computer appealing to a specific niche, typically a niche that could afford to buy the increased processing power, and probably wanted to show it off to their friends, who at the time had graphically underpowered and game-lacking PCs. The cartridge-based formats of the consoles was also offering more than disc-based systems probably could offer. Let's be honest, spreading a game over several discs or requiring a disc swap just to get to the title screen, I'm looking at you gods, isn't the most convenient.
The rocker switch at the back, it's got an expansion port here as well, so you can plug stuff in. You could plug various peripherals in, which were sort of, you could essentially make this into an Amiga 1200 by ramming stuff into it. Bit of a Frankenstein Amiga 1200, but you could do it if you wanted to go down that route. If you wanted to go down the console route and then the conversion route, if you were that way inclined, if you were a bit of a mentalist, huh? First, let's look at these clips. The clips that inspired me to like it in the first place, although I didn't actually own one myself at the time. Too much money!
I never found out why he chose me to share his secret. Perhaps because we had similar dreams. But this was twice as fast. Twice as powerful as anything I'd ever thought possible. Though what that meant, I could never have foreseen. Incredible graphics. And colors. So many colors. Our world would never be the same again.
Have a look at this. The new Amiga CD32, the first 32-bit console to be launched in this country. Software? Well, there's not very much of it around at the moment. There are only 4 games available, but more are promised by Christmas. 80, in fact. Honest. Now, when you buy the console, you get all the usual bits and pieces. You get your mains adapter, etc. And you get this rather strange-shaped controller. Why it's this shape, I've no idea. It doesn't seem to improve playability. In fact, it's just a nuisance. You also get 2 games. You get a game called Oscar and this one, Diggers, which is, well, it takes ages to get going, and then it's really slow, and it's sort of like Lemming.
So, this is the Commodore Amiga CD32, and it's quite a landmark machine. First 32-bit CD-ROM-based console. This is one of the first edition ones. It was manufactured in September 93. Can you see that? And most of the reason why it did so well in the UK and parts of Europe. It had its limitations. It didn't have any storage capacity for save games, unlike its technically equivalent counterpart, the Amiga 1200. But the fact it was a console, the fact it had CD, was a massive buying point for a lot of people. And the hardware wasn't too shabby itself. It ran on the 1200 AGA chipset, which, although it wasn't good at 3D, was pretty much more powerful than most other things available at the time. Point of contention is always the control pads. Control pads look like they're upside down. In fact, they're not upside down. They're designed like that. I quite like them. They're quite cheaply made, but then Commodore were on a bit of a cost-cutting exercise and trying to make a quick buck, which they did for a very limited period, until 3D machines came out, machines with better architecture, better capabilities, and a fucking save game feature. The all-important 32. That was like the badge of its time. It's like when you have a car with GTI written on the back. Yeah, look at my car. This is 32. This is like, yeah, check my games console out. You've only got 16 bits. I've got 32. I don't really know what that means. But 32, hey? Look at the grey colour, it's lovely. Look at these photo sockets, you can play CDs. How have you stereo speakers for a games console? How crazy was that? Two controller ports.
Combine this with the fact that piracy was rife on floppies, and you can see why publishers were equally as keen to switch. Clearly, someone at Commodore was keen to push on with the CD format, which offered the best of both worlds. In fact, it was difficult to pirate, but cheap to produce. The advent of a Mega CD format helped to cement Commodore's chosen direction, and soon, out of the dwindling finances of a Commodore pot in the summer of 1992, a rather hasty CD32 idea was born. And although it was designed to make sales as quickly as possible, it was also a good enough piece of kit to stand a chance. The ace that Commodore had up their sleeve was the fact that they already had some pretty good technology in the shape of the new Amiga 1200 AGA chipset. Simply by robbing this and whopping in a CD drive, Commodore cleverly realised that they could arrive in the home console market in some style, which they specifically targeted this time after learning the mistakes of their all-in-one CD TV attempt earlier. Which, to be honest, was way ahead of its time, with consoles such as the Xbox One now only starting to fit that arena. So, they arrived in style, and they did it with the first 32-bit based CD console available in Western Europe. In fact, it was only beaten globally by the Japanese exclusive FM Towns machine, which possessed internal 32-bit architecture, but in fact only possessed a 16-bit data bus. So, time was on Commodore's side, but it was also rapidly beginning to run out. When the CD32 hit the market, the only real competition the machine faced was Sega's Mega CD, a machine with which the CD32 actually drew a lot of comparisons, with similar intro screens, a similar technical specification, with the Mega CD being two 16-bit 68000 processors as opposed to the 168020 in the 32, and they both employed similar marketing tactics.
It's nowhere near as much fun, but amazing 32-bit games are coming, they promise us. This is called Rise of the Robots, a futuristic beat-em-up that makes full use of the machine's huge palette of over 16 million colours. And, like any CD system, it makes full use of CD-quality sound and CD-quality music. And as we've said so many times on this programme before, you get a better value of game for your money on CD than you do from a floppy or a cartridge, and that's because, of course, a CD can hold so much more information. This, I'm sure you'll recognise as James Pond Robocod, but on the CD32, this game has an amazing 140 levels. I only hope they've included level codes.
To begin the story of the CD32, we have to get down and dirty in the 1980s, and more specifically the latter part of the 80s. At that time, Commodore were dominating the home computer hardware scene, especially in the UK and Europe, where the PC had yet to establish a firm foothold for the average home user. This was in part due to the higher cost of the IBM compatible machines, but also because the tried and tested method of a rectangular shaped computer hooked up to the home television had been in place for a decade, starting off with the affordable Sinclair ZX80 back in 1980 and surging forward like a digital juggernaut. The Commodore Amiga range, along with the Atari ST models, seemed like a natural progression from the 8 to 16-bit technology, and the superior capabilities of the Amiga helped it to quickly dominate this scene. However, before the 80s were out, a new type of computing device started to take over the television screens in homes across the land. This computing device was called the Games Console. What crazed witchcraft was this, you ask? These sleek, shiny, keyboardless devices, in the common guises of the Master System and the